I'm excited to preach this message, and as I get ready to preach this, I think it kind of follows the theme for today. This is how we fight our battles, and I just want to preface this sermon by asking you to open up your heart to the Holy Spirit. I think that there's times where we come in and we hear the word, and we're not really open to what maybe God might be saying. We might be, we're looking for a specific thing. God, I want God to say this to me today. I want God to meet this need in my life today. How many of you guys know that sometimes God does exactly what you don't want him to do? Sometimes God hammers the nail in the exact spot you don't want him to go. You're like, I would like to start on the right, and God's like, I'm starting on the left. I'd like to start in the front, God's like, I'm starting in the back. And so, every time we come to hear the word of God, we need to put ourselves in a position where we're open and willing and ready to receive whatever he has for us. Amen?
Amen.
You know that God knows your needs better than you know yourself?
Absolutely.
And many times as I'm preparing for a sermon, I'm just going to be honest with you. I've never, ever once in 7 years now, I've never prepared a sermon and been thinking about another person in the church. I've never wrote a sermon and I'm like, man, Lena needs to hear this. I mean, this is for her. I've never once done that. Usually as I'm writing a sermon, I'm like, I might as well just get rid of my computer monitor and just put a mirror there. Because it's like, every time I write it, it's like God is speaking it directly to me. And he's challenging me, and he's calling me higher, and he's calling me deeper, and whatever other metaphors and ways you want to look at it. So I'm usually preaching a message that I believe that God already preached to me during my prep time. So right now, with everything that's been going on in our world, I've heard over and over and over, and you probably have as well, that this is a real test of faith for the people of faith, right? You guys heard that? This is a test of faith. The things that we're going through, the things that we're facing. We have a lot of chaos in our culture. We have a lot of uncertainty going on. And I've heard it declared, and I received this, that we're going to see more people come to faith this year than we have in a long time. That the churches are going to be full. We receive that word. Amen? I believe it. I also believe that it's going to become much, much more clear who the true followers of Christ are. I believe it's going to become a lot more black and white. I believe there's a lot of followers who find themselves kind of in the gray area of, I believe in Jesus, but I don't really follow Jesus. I believe that they're going to be challenged to pick a side. I don't know how many of you guys you've probably seen, if you're on social media, a lot of the jokes about 2020, like how much worse can it get? We're on like Jumanji level 5, what's in level 6, and all this kind of stuff. Like, basically, it's not going to necessarily just get better. Do you want to know that I welcome that? I welcome the challenge that things are not going to get better in the world. Because I believe as things continue to get worse in the world, that they're going to get better in the kingdom of God. Amen? I believe that people are going to be forced to choose a side. That they're finally going to be forced to say, I'm either picking, I'm with Jesus, or I'm just going to go my own way. And so we're going to see a clear distinction between what I am going to call today fans of Jesus and followers of Jesus. I believe they're two distinct categories. I believe that Jesus has a lot of fans. Do you guys agree with that? I think he has a lot of fans. I think as you read through the Old Testament or the New Testament, you see Jesus ministering on the earth, you see how many fans he had. I mean, the people arrived in the masses. They were excited about what he could do. They were cheering for him. They were watching for him. They were like, what is next? What is he going to do now? And what can he do for me? They were excited about it. They flock to him. It says over and over about the multitudes. What can he do to please me? Everyone loves a good miracle story, right? I mean, even an unbeliever loves a miracle story. They like to see something amazing happen, something unexplainable happen. Everybody wants to be blessed, right? Anybody in this place that does not want to be blessed? Right? We all want to be blessed. We all want gifts, right? We all want God to do things for us and in us. Maybe not necessarily in us, but definitely for us. And I believe this is why Jesus has so many fans. There are a lot of people that do like the idea of Jesus. They like the idea of salvation. That doesn't mean they're saved. They just like the idea. I like the idea of at the end of this life, I get to go to heaven. And that's where, you know, once saved, always saved, as far as I confess my life to Christ and then I just live however I want. That's where that idea comes from. I like the idea of heaven. I say I'm a follower of Jesus, I live like hell, and get to go to heaven. Wrong. Not biblical. Wrong. Jesus has lots of fans. But see, a fan is simply this. It's an enthusiastic admirer. That's what a fan is. It's an admirer. It's like, man, I like what I see over there. I like what I see over there. Like, I'm not necessarily going to get too close to it. I'm going to keep it at a distance. How many of you guys spent a good portion of your life keeping Jesus at least this far? Like, just this, I mean, I like the idea, but I'm like, stay right there, right? We were trying to do social distancing a long time ago with Jesus, right? Stay 6 foot away. You can do whatever you want, say whatever you want, as long as it's really cool, right over there, but don't you dare get in my space. We're enthusiastic admirers. But I want to tell you there's a difference between a fan and a follower, because a fan is an admirer, but a follower is a person who imitates. A follower is a person who copies or takes something as a model for their life. See, the people in the gray area right now of their faith, they're all fans. They're all fans. They're all admirers. They all like the idea of Jesus. They like the benefits of Jesus. They like the pleasure they get from knowing who Jesus is. They like the wonder of what he can do, but that's it. There's no commitment for a fan. They don't imitate him. They don't follow him in a way that he is the model for their life. I've got a good example for you. How many people in this room, and I know some of you are not sports fans at all, but how many are either a fan of the Cubs or the Cardinals? Just one or the other. If you were going to say you're a fan, you're going to pick one of those teams, okay? So here's the thing. You're a fan of that team. It means that you admire that team. It means that you look at that team, and that team gives you some kind of feeling of wonder, some kind of feeling of pleasure. There's something you enjoy about that team. You're a fan. It's your team, right? That's why we say we won, we lost, because you associate with them like, that's my team. I'm a fan of them. But now, how many of you people that like the Cubs or the Cardinals, you're a fan of one of those teams, how many of you can name 5 players on that team? There's probably about, no joke, 10% of the number of hands are up again. Okay? So I'm going somewhere with this. How many of you can name the manager of that team? How many of you can name the top up-and-coming prospect for that team? The numbers were down to 1, by the way. We're down to 1. So it got harder and harder. We can go a little bit easier. How many of you can name the stadium that team plays in? Okay? The numbers are going back up. I got some easy questions for you guys that are, you know, these fans of the teams. How many of you can name the last time they won the World Series? How many of you won the most recent World Series out of the 2 teams? So, all right. Sorry, that was a sidetrack. That was not actually in my notes, but that was 2016. All right. So, you can answer these questions, okay? You can answer a lot of these questions about the simple questions, but as it gets deeper and it gets deeper and it gets deeper, what that does is it creates a divide between who are the fans and who are the followers. Okay, it's not a bad thing to be a fan. I'm not saying that it's bad at all, but when you're a follower, here's what the thing is. You track what they do. You invest a little bit more. Your life is a little more tied to them because you follow along on them. You actually, remember what a follower does? The follower imitates, right? A follower is probably going to imitate them. You're probably going to be like me and have, at one point, I had more Cubs shirts than I had regular shirts. And my wife is like, something's got to give here. Like, you don't need to wear a Cubs shirt 8 days a week, okay? But you will imitate them. You will even take them as a model. See, you start to declare, like, they represent me, I represent them, I am in them, they are in me. See, we kind of take it that way. We associate with that team when we're a follower. We get kind of deep-rooted. We become, like, we think we are actually on the team. I follow a Cubs blog, and some of the people that comment down in the comments, like, they think that they own the team. Right? They're like cheapskate owners, like, we can buy this guy, pay for this guy, and do this. And I'm like, it's not your money. It's easy for you to say that. Right? But that's how deep-rooted a follower gets, is where it's like you're so deep-rooted that you feel like you are a significant part of that team or of that thing. Now, I'll say that a follower is also a fan, right? Now, you start at fandom and you become a follower. So a follower is a fan, but a fan is not necessarily a follower. You know these people because you can start to create a divide and weed them out by asking questions. You can begin to figure out where people are at. Now, I'm going to tell you that when it comes to baseball, quite frankly, it doesn't matter if you're a fan or a follower. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. They'll take your money just the same, right? And a fan will argue with a follower just the same as a follower and a follower. I mean, it doesn't matter when it comes to those things. These things are not significant. But I want to tell you that when it comes to Jesus, there's a significant difference between a follower and a fan, because now we're talking the difference between eternity in heaven or eternity in hell. That's the difference we're talking about. The stakes have been raised here. I don't know how many, I probably know how many of you guys are real true followers of your sports teams, but let me tell you, I really don't care. What I care about is, are you a fan or a follower of Jesus? I'm afraid that what we call the church in America today, that much of it is filled with fans. Much of it is filled with people who love the idea of Jesus and what he can do, what he can provide for them. They show up to church about as often as they show up to a baseball game, right? Have a good time. It was fun. I enjoyed it, like, sincerely. I plan to come back again. I'm going to do that again sometime. Jesus is fun. He's exciting. He's good. But they fall short of making him a model for their life. Here's something. The fan gets all of the pleasure, but doesn't have to suffer any of the pain. Right? I mean, think about a fan of a baseball team. If you're a fan, how many of you have ever, your mood has swung based on whether your team won or lost? If you're a fan, you're like, I don't care. I watched part of the game. It was over. I went and mowed the grass. If you're a follower, you're kind of like, you're invested. And you're like, I cannot believe it. They got cheated, right? That was a bad call behind the plate, because you're more emotionally invested, right? A fan gets all the pleasure and doesn't have to suffer any of the pain. Can I tell you, it's the same way when you're a fan of Christ? You get all the goodness of God, right? All the blessing, all the favor, all the good things. We're going to be rich and eat and be fat and happy and all these things, the blessings of God. The message of the cross says you got to die. The pain of being a follower is unknown to the fan. It's unknown to them. The fan comes and goes as they want. They come and go, but they don't ever really learn and grow, because they don't get invested. They don't get pulled in. Jesus told us in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, he said to them all, if anyone desires to come after me. Let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Guys, this is the challenge for every Christian. Yes. Every fan, every follower, this is the challenge. If you want to come after Jesus, you guys know that that's what he actually commanded us to do, was to go after him. I'm not just talking about come and follow me, but he commanded us to follow up his actions on the earth. To come after. We're part two, right? It's like Jesus came and set the precedent and laid the groundwork and did the heavy lifting, and then he said, all right, part two, you guys are up. Come after me. Come and do what I have taught you. Come and observe the things, teach them to others, raise the dead, heal the sick, cast out demons, cleanse the lepers. He tells them, do these things. You guys are part two. Be the light, right? Share the gospel. Make disciples. Do greater things than he did. If you want to do that, it starts with you must deny yourself. Maybe you guys find that to be a really easy thing to do. Deny yourself. It's pretty simple. This is all that it means. Say no. Try right now to say no.
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 It was hard, wasn't it? Now say it to your neighbor. Say no.
No.
That was easy. Now say it to yourself. Nobody said it. That's exactly what I thought. That's exactly what I thought would happen. It's hard to say no to yourself. It's difficult to say no to yourself. If you don't deny yourself, you're going to deny Jesus. I'm just telling you. That's a hard truth. But if you don't deny yourself, you will deny Jesus. That's a hard one to swallow. Let it sink in for just a second. See, naturally, what you desire and what he desires are at odds. See, they want different things. You want different things than what he wants for you. Naturally, because of the fall, because of sin, the soul is in constant rebellion to the spirit. Until you say no. See, you're the one that gets to decide when the soul obeys the spirit. You're the one that gets to decide when is my mind, will, and emotions going to obey the perfect Holy Spirit of God that dwells within me. You get to decide that. And it happens when you say no. Fans don't say no to their self. They just say no to Jesus when they're challenged by the word. When they're convicted by the spirit, they say no. Holy Spirit's bad. Right? That's what people say when they feel conviction of the Spirit, when they don't want to yield to the Spirit. Do you know that one of the greatest things that you receive in salvation is the ability to tell yourself no? That's one of the greatest things that you receive. See, we look at salvation, we look at the picture of the cross, and we only watch Passion of the Christ maybe on Easter, but we don't want to watch the rest of the year because it's too gruesome. It's too hard to bear. It's too hard to watch because we just like the idea of salvation means I go to heaven. Salvation also means that you can tell yourself no. It means you now have the power to tell yourself no. And if you follow Jesus, I can promise you that the road that you're going to be headed down is contrary to the road that the rest of the world is following. It's contrary, so you're going to have to say no. You're going to have to, I mean, it's like we had these trails where we were camping, and my kids went down when it was getting kind of dark, and they're like, it was kind of creepy back there. And there were spider webs everywhere. I had a stick that was like a cross. I just happened to find it in the weeds, and I walked through there like this with it. And what I was doing was I had, it went up and down side to side. I was really just taking down cobwebs, and Christy thought I was like, cleansing the earth. I only prayed in tongues for part of it, but it was still, you know, so I told my kids where that stick was at, and I was like, go down the trails, and they're like, it's kind of dark, it's kind of creepy, you know? And I kind of picture as we go down the road, right, the word tells us that the path following Christ is the narrow road, mm-hmm. right? It's the narrow road, and I kind of view it as there's these creeps out in the trees, and they're trying to persuade you, hey, come over here. Hey, stop over here. This will be easier. This will be more fun. We've got to learn to be able to say no. I'm not following you. I'm following Jesus. I'm going to tell you that the road that Jesus will take you down leads away from sin and toward righteousness. Paul told us in Titus chapter 2, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age. That means you and me, right here, right now, because of our salvation in Christ that has appeared to us, that we are being taught by the Spirit that we should deny ungodliness. We should refuse it. We should say no. We should deny worldly lust, the things the world has to offer that says this is good, this is fun, this is what's popular. We should be able to say no. I don't want that. That's not for me. We should instead live soberly, thinking right, thinking clearly, unhindered. We should be living righteously and godly today, not tomorrow. Today. It starts today. Are we going to follow Christ? Deny yourself. The second thing he told us is we have to take up our cross daily. Say daily. This is important. Too many times we think things in Christianity are a one-time event, and very, very few of them are. Take up your cross daily. It's a daily decision that you make. What does that mean? Choose to die daily. Every day you get out of bed and you say, it's not my life to live but Christ. I choose that. I choose that today I'm not going to live for Tim. I choose that today I'm going to live for Christ. You know what? I had to make that decision this morning. When my alarm was going off at 6 o'clock and me and Rocky were up until 1 watching the fight last night, I had to choose that. Tim wanted to stay in bed, I'm telling you. I said, you know what? I don't live this life for Tim. I live this life for Christ. And the sacrifice that I made last night, that sacrificed Tim's time, not Jesus's. Tim's time to sleep. I gave that up because I'm here to serve the Lord today. We got to make these choices daily. The great theologian A.W. Tozer, somebody asked him one time, they said, A.W., what does it mean to take up your cross? And he told a story of an old man, and here's how it went. He said, one time a young man came to an old saint who taught the deeper life, the crucified life, and he said, Father, what does it mean to be crucified? The old man thought about it for a moment, and he said, well, to be crucified means three things. So take note of these, because this is what it means to take up your cross. First, the man who is crucified is facing only one direction. See, when you're crucified, you can only face forward. You can't look back. He said, next, he told me, he said, son, the man on the cross, the other thing you need to know is he is not going back. He has said his final goodbyes. And thirdly, the man on the cross has no future plans of his own. He said, did you get that? He's going one direction. He's not going back. And his future is not his own. This is what it means to take up your cross. You choose to die. You say, it's not about me anymore, but life is Christ. If you're going to move from a fan to a follower, you got to follow Jesus to the most important place that he went, and that was Calvary. You got to follow him there. This place where he demonstrated what he had told us repeatedly. How many times do you see Jesus talk about his submission to the Father? Not my will, but yours be done. How many times do you see him speak like this and go off and pray and do things that he probably in his flesh didn't really want to do, but he knew that he was here on this earth for a purpose, and it was to be submitted to the Father. And he told us that over and over, but I want to tell you that at Calvary, that's where he actually showed us what he had been saying. He declared full submission to the Father in heaven, but it wasn't all talk. He proved it by action. Because Jesus is a doer. He's not just a talker. We talk so much about the things that Jesus said. And he said amazing things, but I think the things that he did are just as important. Because he gave us an example to follow. Now I'm going to go somewhere where you guys have no idea what I'm talking about. You're just going to have to hang on for a minute. Have you guys ever heard the phrase, hold my beer? Right? Like it's a funny thing that people are doing online, and it's like, you know, oh, well, so-and-so did that, well, hold my beer. Meaning, I'm going to go do something crazier. I'm going to go do something more exciting. I'm going to go do something that you guys are really going to be talking about. Like, it's a thing that people turn everything into that joke nowadays, okay? For me, I'd be like, hold my root beer, because that's what I drink, okay? But here, this thing, this phrase expresses that I'm getting ready to do something, well, it really expresses I'm going to do something stupid, usually, but we're going to go with radical. I'm going to do something radical, right? I'm going to do something that you'll never forget. You'll be talking about me next time. I'm gonna do something that is just amazing, outstanding. Somebody did something. I'm going to do something bigger, better, faster, get more views, more likes. It's always about extreme. It's always about making a statement. Can I tell you that if you want to do something wild and crazy and radical and extreme and you want to make a statement, take up your cross. Daily. Amen. You want to do something that'll get people looking at you and talking about you and about how, wow, what a wacko, and take up your cross. Die to yourself and live for Christ. There's nothing more extreme, more radical, more wow, more eye-catching than a person can do. Yes. Live for Jesus. See, fans say, hold my beer, because it's about the thrill of the moment. It's about right here, right now, getting a little bit of attention. But followers take up their cross because it's about a commitment to a new life full of meaning, full of purpose, that goes way beyond popularity and likes on Facebook. It's a whole new life. Are you willing to take up your cross and willingly die to yourself? Thirdly, Jesus says if you can do those things, right? If you're willing to deny yourself, if you're willing to take up your cross daily, then follow me. Sounds simple, doesn't it? We just all need to take a field trip to the Middle East and follow around wherever Jesus went. You know, if you have gotten to this point, if you've gotten to the place where you can deny yourself, if you've gotten to the place where you can take up your cross daily, you're in too deep. There's no looking back, right? I mean, you are committed. At this point, you've already been able to tell yourself no. You died to self, turning from sin, walking in righteousness. It seems that following Jesus should be the easy step. But yet, sometimes we make it so hard, so difficult. I'm going to tell you why. I think there's a key to following Jesus. We often try to do it alone. I don't mean just not with the body of Christ. I mean, we try to follow Jesus without Jesus. Anybody ever done that? I've done it over and over. Here's an example. How many of you guys have ever been on a road trip with multiple cars? Like a big family thing, or you're following some friends somewhere. How many of you have ever had to be the one to follow somebody else. Mm-hmm. Right? It's terrible. It's the worst experience you may ever have in your life, is following somebody else. Because everybody is a worse driver than you. Right? I mean, let's just be honest. Everybody is a worse driver than you. Everybody doesn't know how to use their cruise or, you know, whatever. It's awful. But let's just, for the sake of the scenario, you're following, everybody's following Dustin. So, hang on. Everybody grab your handle, be ready, okay? But as you follow him, there's a few things that are going to happen, okay? He takes off, you take off, right? It's pretty simple. I mean, it's mostly self-explanatory. But he has the directions. He knows where you're headed. You may kind of know kind of where you're headed, but you don't necessarily know how to get there. And so you're relying on him. I'm going to follow him. I'm going to go where he goes. See, when he speeds up, I'm going to speed up. My job's just to follow. I got to keep up with him. If he slows down, then I'm going to slow down. If he begins to turn, then I'm going to turn. If he says, hey guys, we're stopping and we're going to rest, which he would never do, then you're going to stop and you're going to rest. Okay, because you're following him, so he's in charge. You as the follower, you're relying on his leadership. Now, personally, I can't stand being in car number 234 or whatever. I like to be the leader. I like to be the guy that gets to decide, no, we're not stopping. Yes, we're driving this speed. We're going to take this route. We're going to do this way. I like to be that guy. I like to be first. Quite frankly, here's what I like. Give me the address. I will punch it in my phone. I will see you there. Quite frankly, I don't even really want people following me. Because when they're following you, you're like, what are they doing? Right? Get off of me. Back up. Are you trying to count that? How many hairs I'm missing on the back of my head, or what's your problem? Or what are they doing all the way back there? I mean, I'm driving the speed limit. Why are they three towns back? I'm in Effingham, they're in Bluff City. What is wrong with you? Right? I mean, I don't even necessarily want to lead the other people. I just want you to give me the address. I'll punch it in. I'll meet you there.
Yes.
That's how we did our trip this last time. It was amazing. It was the best. My mom and dad got there. My brother and sister-in-law got there. My sisters got there. I don't even know who got there when or whatever. I just know I showed up last and didn't care. It's like, I made it here in one piece. It was stress-free. It was really stress-free because Xander was driving and I was sitting in the back seat. So I had no responsibility. But that's the way we like it, right? Just give me the address. Let me punch it in and I will meet you there. But see, with our walk with Christ, our walk with Christ needs to be more like the first scenario. He's the leader. He not only knows the destination, but he also knows the path and the pace and when we're going to brake and when we're not going to brake and when we're going to turn and all these things, when we need to slow down, speed up. He knows all those things, and your job is just to follow him. That's the way that it should be. But too many of us would rather just punch heaven into the GPS and say, you know what, Jesus? I'll see you there. I'm going to go my own way. I'm going to do my own thing. I'm going to do my own, take my own path. I'll see you there. Anybody besides me been guilty of that? I don't really think that's best for us, church.
No.
I don't think it's best to just say, Jesus, I appreciate the address, and I will see you there. See, this is the problem with following Jesus. See, a lot of us would see that as, I'm a follower. But I don't think you are. I didn't follow any of them down to Golconda, to the cabins. I had the address. I made my own path. I met them there. Would anybody in their right mind be like, you followed them down there? I didn't follow them down there. I don't even know when they got there. And we try to treat Jesus like that. Well, you know what? I know that it says follow you, but if we end up in the same place, I mean, really, it's kind of like I followed you. right? Because you're here, and then now I got here. So it's like I followed you. But I want to tell you something about Jesus. See, when Jesus said, follow me, when we try to do it on our own like that, we're missing such an important piece. He said, follow me because he wants to be with you now. He wants you to take the journey with him. He wants you to be by his side, for him to be by your side. He wants to do this journey with you, and I'll prove it to you. Because the Greek word here for follow is akalutheo, meaning to join one or accompany one. So when Jesus said, follow me, he didn't say, meet me there. He said, join me. He said, accompany me. Come alongside of me. Following Jesus is more than obeying a set of directions. And we've got to stop treating it like that's all it is. Well, I read the Bible and I do what it says and I'll meet you there, Jesus. No, that's not what it's about. It's about accompanying him along the journey. It's about going along with him. Listen, this journey is a call for the rest of your life. It's not just, I'll take my home pit stops. You stop when he stops. You turn when he turns. If you don't, you're not following him anymore. If you break course and break path, listen, you better get on the phone and be like, man, I'm an idiot. Where are you at? Anybody ever had to do that when you're following somebody before? One time, I don't even remember where we were going. One of us, I think everybody else went on 57 and I went on 24. When you're going south, I'm like, I'm an idiot. Where are you guys at? I was just trying to follow you, but somewhere, some way, I think I was looking for a bathroom or something. And we got lost. Man, if you get off track, you better call Jesus and say, where do you want me? Where do I need to go to get back on track? Because it's not about meeting him at the destination. It's about being on the journey with him. I know this is hard. I know that it's hard to do. But listen, Hebrews 4:15 tells us, we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. Anybody got weaknesses? Just one or two? I mean, little ones, no big deal. But he was in all points, say all points.
All points.
He was tempted as we are, yet without sin. Can I tell you, first of all, I don't know if you saw it, and I don't even remember his name because I don't pay that much attention to these people, but there was a news anchor that declared just a few days ago that Jesus admittedly was not perfect. And I'm like, I don't know what Jesus you're talking about, but mine was perfect. Mine was without sin. He who knew no sin was made to be sin for us, so that we can become the righteousness of God in him. Right here it says that he was tempted in all points as we are, yet he was without sin. He can sympathize with our weaknesses. Now let me tell you what Jesus did have. Temptation. He did have temptation. I'm telling you that if it says that he was tempted in all ways that we are, yet he was without sin, it means there were times, there were moments where there was something within him, the humanity side of him, that he did not want to do what the Father told him to do. There had to be points where he just wanted a day off. There had to be points where maybe I don't want to go over there. I want to go over here. Yet every single time, he chose to submit. He knows what it's like to have that temptation to go your own way. He knows what it's like to have the temptation to want to do your own thing. What he knows is he knows how to tell himself no. What he doesn't know is how to go his own way. What he doesn't know is rebellion. What he doesn't know is disobedience. He was tempted, but he didn't. That should bring us comfort knowing that at least my God, my Savior, knows my struggles. At least he knows what I'm going through. Listen, he literally carried his cross after he was beaten, after his back was ripped open and shredded. After that, he carried his cross. You're only being asked to do it spiritually. You're not even being asked to physically carry a cross. He knows what you're going through, but listen, Jesus came to save you from your sin. There are little words in the Bible that we often overlook, and that's one of the most important ones. He came to save you from your sin, to remove you from it. He came to set you free. Amen? That's what Pastor Tom preached about last week. Freedom. Hallelujah. He came to heal you. He came to deliver you. But I want to tell you this morning that those benefits are for the followers. They're not for the fans. Those are only for the followers. They're not for the fans. The fans get the goosebumps. The followers get the actual blessing. I don't know about you. I mean, I'll gladly take both, but if I get to pick one, I'll take the blessing. I don't want to just feel, ooh, man, that's great. God is here. What do you? I want the blessing. Pour it out. Whatever work you need to do in me, do it. Go for it right now. I want to leave here feeling on fire and alive and awake and ready to conquer this world. Not like I need a sweater. Okay? You can have both, because you can be a fan and a follower. Fans. Listen to this. This is what the Lord showed me this morning. Fans get their inheritance. They go off. They have a good time doing their ungodly desires, blowing it at the bars and the strip clubs, only to one day wake up eating pig slop. You know who that is? Prodigal son? Sound familiar? That's where fans end up. Fans end up, Lord, give me. Give me some stuff so I can go have some fun, live my way, do whatever I want, all these ungodly passions, and then one day they wake up bankrupt. And they're like, wow, that was a waste of time. Listen, done been there, did that. Blew my inheritance. Praise God for redemption in Christ. Amen? Followers live what might appear to our eyes as less glamorous lifestyles. But I'm going to tell you something about followers. Every need is met. Amen. And they have every spiritual blessing. Yes. It's all theirs. And peace and joy remains in them. That's what you get when you're a follower. Jesus, when he paid the price for sin on the cross, I want to tell you that it was more than just a payment. It was about redemption. It was about new life, guys. 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Fans don't become the righteousness of God. You know why? They see it as a possession that they can take hold of. They can put it on when they want it. They can take it off when they don't want it. That's what they see it as. But a follower realizes that righteousness is not something that you possess. It's something you become. Amen. And you can only become it in Christ. Amen. It's only found in him. Yes. Jason, if you'd come up. This morning, I got some questions for us to consider as we wrap up this morning. We've got to ask ourselves these questions. We've got to do a self-inventory today, church. Are you willing to deny yourself? Are you willing to tell yourself no? Because it starts right there. It starts with me saying, no, Tim. No, you can't do that. No, you don't want to do that. No, you shouldn't do that. No, God would not be pleased with that. You know better. No. The answer is no. How many of you guys don't have any trouble telling your kids no? Two hands. I got no trouble. No trouble telling my kids no. Maybe we need to have no trouble telling ourselves no. Maybe we need to get to that point where it's like, you know what? If it ain't good for you, self, I'm going to tell you. There ain't no, I'm not trying to keep you happy. I don't care if you're mad at me. What do you tell your kids? What's the popular phrase? You'll get
over it.
Over it. You'll get over it. Yeah, you hate me right now. You'll get over it. Big deal. There's a point where I told my parents I hated them too because they wouldn't let me do what I wanted when it was bad for me. You know what they told me? I don't care. They probably said you'll get over it, but I know I heard I don't care. Don't care. So today I want you to think about that with yourself. There's things that you need to start to tell yourself no about. And when yourself starts to get a little puffed up, get a little worked up, starts to, you know, you can tell it just getting ready to start throwing a fit. Needs a whooping, right? You need to say, no, I don't care, right? I also heard that. Go ahead, throw your fit, don't care. You'll get over it, right? Tell yourself those things. Whatever it takes to tell yourself no, then take up that cross. Choose that today, man, today's not my day. You know what? That's such a worldly thought. Man, today is your day. You live your best life. You do what makes you happy. No, you don't. Not if you're a child of God. You do what makes Him happy. Amen. You live that life for Him and Him alone. And I'm going to tell you that when you do that, you will find that you are pleased. You will find that you have peace and joy. You'll find that you're living a great life. Are you willing to die to yourself? And are you willing to actually follow Jesus, not just meet Him there, not just I'll see you at the end of the road? There's a lot of people that are, man, what is that trumpet going to sound like? Like, I need to make sure it doesn't sound too much like the fire whistle, right? I need to make sure it doesn't sound like, you know, the neighbor kid playing his awful instrument that I pray every day that he gets good at one day, right? We want to know, what is that trumpet going to sound like? I don't want to miss it because I'm kind of living life however I want. I want to make sure I can run out at the last second and be like, here I am. Don't forget me. No, are we going to follow Jesus right now? Are we going to say, Lord, I'm in this with you. I don't want to just meet you there, but I want you by my side. I want to be by your side. I want to do this life with you. If you would stand to your feet this morning. You know, Jesus challenged us to count the cost. Count the cost. You know, if you count the cost, here's something about counting the cost is, when you count the cost, what you're going to come down to is you're going to be faced with something. Here's what I have to give up. Here's what it's going to cost me. And you got to understand that the cost of following Christ, the cost from going from a fan to a follower, is steep. It's a steep cost. You will have troubles. You will. Guaranteed, you'll have troubles. You will be rejected. You will be denied. You'll be challenged. You'll be called out. You'll have to do uncomfortable things. Your eyes will be open to the ugliness of your sin. You'll have to leave some things behind. And you'll have to humble yourself. Sounds fantastic, doesn't it? It is a steep cost, guys. But these are the things that a fan will not give up. A fan won't give these things up, and that's why they remain a fan. It's why they remain an admirer. I like the idea. of what Christ can do, but it's not going to cost me a thing. I'm staying at arm's distance. It doesn't make sense sometimes to a fan. 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. The power of God. Listen, there's a lot of things that it's going to cost to be a follower of Christ, but can I tell you that there's even more to gain? Can I tell you that what you will gain totally outweighs, overshadows, and puts to shame the things that you would have to lose? The challenge to count the cost, I don't believe that Jesus gave that to discourage people from following. He didn't do that like, listen, man, that is going to cost you a lot. You need to be sure you want to do it. I know we frame it that way a lot. I don't think it's to discourage people from taking the plunge. I think it's so that they have a reality of what's actually going to happen if you choose to follow him. It's a reality. These things will happen. But it's totally worth it. You're going to gain new life, abundant life. Guys, acceptance. You're going to gain rest. Hallelujah. Peace. Joy. Reconciliation. You're going to join into a family. And you gain the Spirit of the living God dwelling within you, empowering you to be a witness, to overcome, to say no. Hallelujah. These are the things that you gain. It's time to make the call. It's time to make the decision. It's time for the fence riders to pick a side. Amen. Listen, we don't know how much longer we've got. We don't know how much worse 2020 is going to get, but tell you what, there's going to be a point where you're going to have a hard time finding a seat in here. I believe that in every church in this community, in this region. Today's the day. Are you a fan or a follower? When you think about, back to your, some of you, it's been a long time, but your dating dates. Maybe some of you are in that place right now. When you're interested in a person, when you spend some time with a person for a while, you get to a point where this question comes to mind. Where is this relationship going? Right? Where is this going? Should we continue to pursue a relationship or should we call it quits? Are we going to commit to one another? Are we going to get married, do life together? Are you going to become, are we going to become followers of one another or just fans? I believe some of the people hearing my voice right now are just fans of Jesus, and it's time to ask yourself the question, where do you see this relationship going? Where do you see it going? Are you ready to commit, to deny yourself, take up your cross, to follow him? Church, I want to do this with all my heart, no matter what it costs. No matter what it costs, I want to live my life with Christ. No matter what it costs, no matter what I have to give up, no matter what I lose, no matter if I end up chained to a wall in jail one day because of my faith, if I end up beheaded on a video on YouTube, I don't really care. Because I want to live for Jesus no matter what the cost is. Now hear me when I tell you this, but I desperately want a full church. But I don't want a church full of fans. Amen. I want a church full of followers. Amen. I want a church full Amen. Of people who are willing to give it all Amen. For the sake of Jesus Christ, for the one who gave it all for you. And you know what? If you're not ready to make that decision, I'm not saying if you're not a fan that you can't come. I'm just saying you got to get to that place. We've got to find ourselves in that place of desperation where we say enough is enough. I'm tired of living life the way that I've been living. I'm tired of just riding on Jesus for the highs. I'm tired of trying to go my own way and just hopefully, listen, you punch heaven into the GPS and what happens is you end up living life where you're hoping you end up in the same place. You ever got somewhere and you're like, did I type in the right address? This does not look like where I thought I was going. That's what your faith is like. If you're just hoping to meet up with Jesus at the end, you might get there and be like, this is not what I thought heaven was going to look like. Listen, if you follow Jesus, you know where you're going. If you follow Jesus, you have a confidence in your eternal salvation. The Holy Spirit is the stamp. He's the mark. He's the guarantee of the inheritance of heaven for your life, guys. Father, right now as we come to this decision time, Lord, as we open up the altars, as we go back into worship, Lord, we trust that your word does what it says, that it doesn't return void. We trust that it impacts our heart, that it's sharper than a two-edged sword, that it can pierce between the joint and the marrow, that it can infiltrate and get in places that we didn't even know that it had access. And right now, we just pray that each and every person at the sound of my voice, Holy Spirit, do the work that you need to do. As we surrender to you, we open up our hearts to you. As I asked everybody to do at the beginning, we do it right now. We reopen if we put walls up. If we close down shop, we reopen to you and we say, Holy Spirit, have your way. Father, I pray that each and every person here would leave this place as a follower, as a person who can say no to themselves, as a person who lives for you daily, as a person who pursues you and your interest in your path and walks with you. Lord, help us to surrender right now. Holy Spirit, right now begin to peck on people's hearts. There may be things that they need to start saying no about. There may be plans and hopes and dreams that they have that they need to give over to you because that's not the plan that you have for their life. Help us to follow you truly. We surrender to you. Do what you want. In Jesus' name, amen.